All right, let's talk about what object-oriented programming means from a more conceptual standpoint. In my previous videos, I have explained how the idea behind objects is that we want to encapsulate data and we want to encapsulate functionality inside of a data structure. All right. So, for example, imagine that we were writing a program where we wanted to store or manipulate data that is associated to a person, right? So for example, if we have a person called John Doe, we may want to store his name as a string, right? His age as an integer, his height as a double, right? And whether if this person is a student or not as a boolean, right? If it's just this one person, we probably could be fine by using individual variables to store each one of the data points that make up this overall idea of a person, right? Now, but if we wanted to store like a second person, then we would have to go through a similar process where we now create more variables, but we may have to call them now name one and name two, h1 or name h2, height one or height two for Jane, which is also going to have like her age, her height, and whether if she's a student or not, right? So, okay, maybe if we're only storing two people, maybe this could be okay, but it's already for me, that I have like a small degree of OCD, for me it's already a painful thing to have to like have this variable name one, h1, name two, h2. It's confusing. It's a little my program would not be clean. And also if I have more than two people, you can see how easily this gets out of control, right? So perhaps the idea behind objects is that it feels convenient to be able to say, well, let me create something that is going to be called John and is going to be representing all the properties that John has: name, age, height, and student, right? So if I were able to say, let me create something called John, and then John is going to contain a variable inside of him, which is going to be the name, and which is probably going to be a string, another variable called age, which is going to be an integer, the height and the student as variables that belong to this more complex thing that we're calling here John. All right. This is what would be an object containing different properties, different variables for each one of these. And for Jane, we could do a very similar thing where now we're going to create a Jane object, right? Which is going to contain similar identical properties, name, age, height, blah, 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 but with different values because it's a different person, right? What's very interesting about object-oriented programming is that objects are this higher level structure. So John and Jane would be an object, right? Each one of them containing properties, name, age, height, and whether if they're a student or not. And then it becomes very easy to store those variables inside of those objects. But what's also more interesting is that very often, when we are, and you can see how these objects, John and Jane, are kind of representing a higher level idea, which is a person, because most people that I can think of, they probably all share these common properties: having a name, having an age, having some a height, and whether if they're students or not, right? You can calculate that for any person in the world, probably. So it turns out that this idea, but each one of these particular objects, John and Jane, would have different values for each one of these properties. So this idea, the idea that we can create objects with different values for different properties, but all the objects kind of have the same pattern. They follow the same template. They all have the same overall properties, but with different values for each one of the different instantiations. This is the core idea behind object-oriented programming. The idea is that if I know that I'm going to be writing a program where I'm going to be storing, representing, and managing a lot of different people, right? Maybe I should be able to create some kind of structure that represents people in general. So I can call that a person class. And then I can design what are going to be the properties or the functionality that these objects, these people are going to have. So for example, we can define that any person that I represent with code will have a name, an age, a height, a weight, and whether they're a student or not. And I will also be able to represent to give those objects functionality. So whether if they can talk, they can walk, if they can run, or they can die, you know? So the general idea, the concept, the template, the design of what kind of properties and what kind of functionality a objects may have, this is what's referred to as classes. Classes is the general idea, the template, the pattern that all objects will follow. And then particular objects, so John, Jane, myself, Jose Luis, whoever is watching this stream right now, particular objects may have different values for each one of the properties, which will be the same. So all people will have names, but each person will have a different value for those names, right? They will have John, Jane, etc., right? And arguably, the way these objects will behave, the way they will talk, the way they will walk, the way they will run, many of those functionalities may actually be affected by the values of these objects. So if we had a property called where the person was born, then the way they would talk would probably be different. I have a Spanish accent because I was born in Spain, right? Probably the way they run might be affected by their weight, right? If they're a little thinner, maybe they run faster. Maybe their age is also affected. The running is also affected by their age. Younger people may run faster than older people. But that functionality may also be not affected by their properties. So arguably, everyone is going to die at some point, you know? So maybe that is not a factor. We'll see examples of how this is. So this idea that we can have a general class as the template that defines all what properties and methods any person will have. And then we have particular instantiations of that class called objects containing different values for those common properties. This is the core of object-oriented programming and the relation between objects and classes. Now, object-oriented programming was, I believe, the first instantiation of objects was in this old programming language called Simula, which was derived from Algol. I'm talking about the 60s and the 70s. But the main programming language that actually popularized object-oriented programming was Smalltalk. Was an Apple-based programming language that was created by Alan Kay, who's a very famous computer scientist, very much in the realm of like cognition and how humans relate to computers, it was so popular, it became so popular and so novel that it actually was picked up by most of the modern programming languages that are out there these days. And I want to make two analogies of what the relation between classes and the relation between objects is, because this leads to a little bit of confusion sometimes. The idea is that, as I have explained before, when we have a class, the class is the general idea, the general concept, right? So, and then objects are different instantiations of that general idea. So if we think, for example, of a car factory, we know that a car factory will be producing cars. So a class that we call a car, that will be the factory, will be able to produce, to churn out many different types of cars, but they will all share some properties. They will all share number of wheels, they will all share the color, they will all share like how many cylinders each car has. However, each particular car that comes out of this factory may have a different color. So some cars will be red, some cars will be black, some cars will be blue, I don't know. Most of the cars will probably have four wheels, but some of them may actually have six wheels if the factory produces trucks, for example, right? The number of cylinders may vary, okay? And then, as a consequence, how fast these cars can go may actually be in relation to how many cylinders the engine has, but will probably not be affected by the color, arguably, right? So in this metaphor, the factory that produces the cars would be the class, because it is what defines all the properties that all cars have. And then each one of the individual cars with their particular values for their properties, color, cylinders, number of wheels, etc. Each one of those will be the objects. So classes are the template, and objects are the individual instantiations with actual data inside of them. All right? Objects here. A bit more, perhaps, like a bit more high level example. I don't know if you're familiar with philosophy, with Plato's philosophy, and Plato's allegory of the cave. But if you are, basically in his philosophy, he used to argue that us mortals in the real plane world, we kind of don't, the way it works, knowledge for us in the plain mortal world is defined by this allegory of the cave, which is basically the fact that we all know what a horse is, all right? So if we see a horse, we all know that horses have like four legs, they have a neck, they have like tail, blah, blah, blah. So us humans, all of us, can identify horses if we go out in the street, if there were horses in the street, whatever, all right? And even though if anybody asks, like, hey, what are the properties of a horse? We would all answer that they have to have four legs. If we actually happen to see a poor horse that only has three of them, we would still identify this horse as a horse, because there's something that makes us know what that horse is. But he would argue that as mortals, that this idea of horseness is actually something that belongs to the divine world. It's something that the idea of what an ideal horse is, an ideal person is, an ideal cat, an ideal tree, all of those ideal ideas live in some kind of divine plane that us mortals don't have access to, but we inherited that knowledge somehow, and that's why we are all able to know what a tree is, what a person is, even though they may have different properties, but we don't have access to the ideal tree or the ideal horse. In this allegory, it's also a little bit of how how classes and objects work. Classes would be these ideal templates that live in the divine world, right? That they're not horses or they're not people themselves, but they are the ideal of what a horse or what a person is. And then in the actual plane world, we are around people, we're around horses, and we can see them, and each one of them has like is a bit taller, a bit faster, they have different colors, etc. But we can all still recognize them as being part of the more general category of horses. All right. So this is a little bit of the conceptual difference, all right, if you will. I don't know which example you relate better with, but those are my offerings here. If you want to learn a bit more about object-oriented, I have a full lecture in my Introduction to Computational Design lectures here at the GSD, so you're welcome to check this out, all right? So enough with theory, how about we actually start talking and start writing our own classes and creating objects from those classes, all right? So let's move on to the next video and let's start from scratch. How does this work and how do we implement this code-wise? All right, let's do it.